The story of Inherent Vice takes place in 1970. During the Cold War between the United States and the Soviet Union, there was a communist wave in Cuba, Vietnam, and other places. The United States not only orchestrated subversion around the world through the CIA, but also participated in the Vietnam War. The main place of the story, Los Angeles, has the largest ideological export factory, Hollywood. Hollywood was on the front lines of the ideological battle after the 1940-1950 the Hollywood blacklist. The fictional character Burke and Shasta are both Hollywood actors. Doc, a private investigator and hippie, is asked by his ex-girlfriend, Shasta, to help investigate real estate mogul Mickey Wolfman. Doc went to Mickey's real estate project. After Doc was knocked out by a mysterious man, Mickey disappeared. The process of investigation is tortuous. Doc is getting deeper into the case, and all the surrounding evidence points to a ship, the Golden Fang. In order to facilitate everyone to understand the plot, I have sorted out four storylines. Number 1. Real estate tycoon, Mickey Wolfman. Mickey likes to draw his lovers on his tie, and Shasta is one of them. After meeting Shasta, Mickey began to take drugs. The hallucinations caused by drug use made him realize his past crimes. He found his conscience and wanted to atone. Mickey's wife Sloane learned about this and tried to discourage it. She planned to send Mickey to the mental hospital Chris Kyladon. Mickey witnesses the murder of his bodyguard Glenn Sherlock by Vigilant California. Vigilant California is a fictional militia group, which is under the command of the LAPD. Glenn was killed for colluding with Tarek, a black gang member. According to the information provided by the book, Vigilant California kidnapped Mickey after killing Glenn. This action was not aimed at Mickey. Because Vigilant California was under the command of the police knew about Mickey's kidnapping. This explains why the police not only didn't go looking for Mickey, but also had a party at Mickey's house. After Mickey was kidnapped, the FBI learned that he was going to distribute his money to the poor, and the FBI had its own ideas about how the money would be used.
The word I'm hearing is that the Department of Justice is trying to broker a Vegas deal for him.
Doesn't compute.
Say again. Vegas Wolfen. FBI stuff. They need somebody else on the strip who's not Italian. You dig? Like Howard Hughes when he bought the Desert Inn.
Howard Hughes was Italian?
No. They want white people. They want white Anglo owners on the strip. Who better than Mickey Wolfman?
In order to make Mickey change, FBI forcibly sent him to Chris Kyladon. Mickey returned to his family after being brainwashed and opened a casino in Vegas. Number 2. The board's band musician, Coy. Coy and his wife are both addicts. After their daughter was born, Coy wanted to change the status quo, so he sought the help of his friend Shasta. Shasta found her friend Burke, a member of Vigilant California, who was able to put Coy into the organization. But Coy must fake his death and leave his family. With his new identity, Coy is active as an informant in various subversive organizations. Coy deliberately stood up and cursed during Nixon's speech in order to break into the subversive group.
Whoa, so what's he, why is he screaming and yelling like that at Nixon again?
Now that he's been on TV, he has instant and wide credibility. Police can infiltrate him into any group they want to.
After becoming an informant, all of Coy's income went to his wife. So Hope, Coy's wife, knew that Coy wasn't dead. After learning that his wife and daughter are getting better, Coy wants to go back home and hopes Doc can help. Number 3. Bigfoot, Detective Lieutenant, Mickey's friend. Bigfoot's former partner Vincent Indelicato was killed by Puck while on a mission. The truth is that the police department hired Prussia to murder Vincent, and Prussia subcontracted the job to Puck. Bigfoot has always wanted to find out the real culprit behind Prussia. So he guides Doc with clues to investigate Puck and Prussia. Why didn't Bigfoot investigate by himself? Chapter 5 mentioned that after his partner was killed, Bigfoot was not only isolated, but also monitored by his peers. But there was something about the way this other cop was listening to them, way too attentive, maybe even, if you wanted to be paranoid about it, as if he was undercover, reporting to some other level inside the LAPD, his real job, basically, to keep an eye on Bigfoot. Therefore, it is inconvenient to investigate the hired killer of the police station. After Doc killed Puck and Prussia, Bigfoot forcibly handed Prussia's heroin to Doc and released a message that Doc robbed the goods. Using Doc as bait, Bigfoot tracked down the fake family who transported the drugs and eventually brought Golden Fang to justice. Number 4. Golden Fang. Golden Fang is both the name of a ship, a conglomerate, a holding company, and an international crime syndicate. Its activities include drug making, drug trafficking, transporting counterfeit money, illegal arms trade, murder, opening a dental clinic, investing in a mental hospital, etc. Golden Fang, the boat, formerly known as Preserved, was bought by the movie star Burke after World War II. Burke was blacklisted by Hollywood because of his communist tendencies. He fled the United States by boat and disappeared in a sea between San Pedro and Papeete. A few years later, Burke appeared in Cuban waters with the Preserved. After returning to America, Burke went back to the big screen and said that he would shoot a film called Commie Confidential. After that, Preserved changed hands and changed its name to Golden Fang. It began to engage in many anti-communist espionage. Doc wants to find out the power behind Golden Fang. The above four clues are the main thread of the story. Next, we will go further and deeper into the core of the story. First of all, Vigilant California is a fictional organization by Pynchon, which may be an insinuation of the American militia organization, the National Guard. The National Guard follows the governor's command. In 1970, the governor of California was Ronald Reagan.
Owing to Governor Reagan's shutdown of most of the state mental facilities, the private sector had been given carte blanche to pick up the slack. Soon, in fact,
Reagan is also mentioned several times in the novel. One is that a pornographer wanted to extort a hush money after mastering the Reagan scandal. So the LAPD hired Prussia to murder the pornographer. I quote, "The governor has some great momentum right now, the future of America belongs to him, somebody can be doing American history a big favor here, Adrian." I went to Wiki to check Reagan's record in California. A few of them intrigued me. Number 1. Reagan was first elected to the board of directors of the Screen Actors Guild. In 1941, he testified to the House Un-American Activities Committee on the Communist Infiltration of Hollywood. He spied on some actors and tipped off to the FBI under the code name T-10. He publicly opposed Hollywood's blacklisting, but privately he and his first wife, Jane Wyman, met with FBI agents in 1947 to inform them of what they considered suspected saboteurs. Number 2. Reagan, who took office as governor of California in 1967, took a hard line against the anti-Vietnam War protests at the time. He dispatched 2,200 National Guard troops directly to the 1969 protests in People's Park, Berkeley. As mentioned earlier, Pynchon made up Vigilant California to insinuate the National Guard. Number 3. Reagan shut down the state mental facilities and replaced involuntary compulsory hospitalization with community-based housing and medical care because he believed it was a violation of civil liberties. It can be seen from the above 3 points that Reagan is an anti-communist conservative who supports war. And Pynchon's fictional world is inextricably linked with Reagan in real history. Reagan aside, let's talk about Mickey. Here is another excerpt from the novel. The bank deposit form Sloan Wolfman had given Doc was from Arbolada Savings and Loan in Ojai. This, according to Aunt Reet, was one of many SNLs Mickey held a controlling interest in. And their customers, how would you describe them? Mostly individual homeowners, what we in the profession refer to as suckers, replied Aunt Reet. And the loans, anything out of the ordinary? Ranchers, local contractors, maybe some Rosicrucians and theosophists now and then. Oh, and of course there's Chris Kyladon, who've been doing a heap of building and landscaping and tacky but expensive interior design lately. To sum up, Mickey has more than one savings and loan institution. This institution, as its name says, has two functions. The focus is on one of Mickey's clients, Chris Kyladon aka Golden Fang, a company that built many houses with loan money.
Jay, you said in your note, beware of the Golden Fang. Why am I supposed to beware of a boat?
They're an Indo-Chinese heroin cartel. A vertical package, they grow it, bring it in, step on it, run stateside networks of local street dealers, and take a separate percentage off of each operation.
So you're dealing smack?
No, but they use Chick Planet as a front to launder money.
Jade told Doc that Mickey's Chick Planet massage was used to launder money for Golden Fang, and then combined with Mickey's Arbolada SNL to lend money to Chris Kyladon, so it can be deduced that the Arbolada SNL is another way of Golden Fang's money laundering. I also found a passage in Chapter 7 that briefly describes the anti-communist activities that Golden Fang was involved in, including the Bay of Pigs invasion in Cuba. Following this text, Pynchon wrote the key message. That Mickey, known to be a generous Reagan contributor. If Mickey is Golden Fang's middleman, is there a possibility that Golden Fang donated crime proceeds to Reagan through Mickey? Why did Golden Fang donate to Reagan? First, Reagan closed the state mental facilities, which made Chris Kyladon a fortune. Second, Golden Fang participated in anti-communist activities and cooperated with the FBI and the CIA, which was consistent with Reagan's interests and positions. Third, Reagan supported the Vietnam War. As long as the war continued, the local government would not be able to spare its resources to manage the Golden Triangle. Golden Fang can unscrupulously plant poppies in the Golden Triangle, at the same time smuggling arms to military forces in Southeast Asia. Mickey laundered money through his massage and SNLs, which Golden Fang used to invest in real estate, a dental office, a mental facility, and possibly Mickey's casino project, and donated to Reagan through Mickey. This also explains why Golden Fang and the FBI sent him to Chris Kyladon for brainwashing after Mickey had a problem, because Mickey is a key node in Golden Fang's cash flow. And his actions also affected the interests of the shareholders behind Golden Fang. So, how powerful is the Golden Fang? Let's start with the Aryan Brotherhood. Although it is Mickey's bodyguard group, Mickey does not trust them. I quote, "What happened, Mickey got to where he didn't always trust his drivers. They were most of MX-cons, which meant they had their own IOUs to pay off that sometimes he didn't know about. Puck, a member of the Brotherhood, works for Prussia, and one of Prussia's businesses is lending money. So is it okay to assume that many members of the Brotherhood have borrowed money from Prussia? Prussia worked for the Golden Fang, which gave the Golden Fang the possibility of controlling the Brotherhood. A very detailed point is that in the film, Doc visits the band's mansion, and the camera deliberately focuses on the members of the Aryan Brotherhood. Then there is the FBI. It is mentioned in Chapter 16 that someone inside the FBI took the counterfeit US currency that Golden Fang shipped from overseas. In Chapter 18, Bigfoot tells Doc that the FBI has strong ties with Golden Fang in the Far East. They teamed up to send Mickey to Chris Kyladon. Then there is the LAPD. Many police officers have borrowed money from Prussia, with extremely low interest rates. Every time he commit a crime, Prussia uses the arrears records to protect himself. It can be seen that most of the powerful agencies and criminal groups can more or less establish some kind of unknown connection with Golden Fang. If the United States is compared to a person, then Golden Fang is the drug that makes the United States addicted. It wants to quit but can't quit. Because Golden Fang has penetrated every vein of American power.
Suppose your mom was on smack.
My mom?
Yeah, what would you do? Wouldn't you try to help her?
Yeah, I think. Are you saying that the U.S. is somebody's mom? And she's, strung out?
I'm trying to.
What?
Sending people off to die in jungles for no reason. Something wrong and suicidal about that that she can't stop.
Golden Fang uses murder, intimidation, donations and bribes, drugs, ideological brainwashing and other means to protect its interests from damage. Burke and Mickey are just a few examples of the many brainwashed. Patients at Chris Kyledon watched Burke's anti-communist films every day.
Chris Kyledon's Motion Picture Palace, now showing the Burke Stodger Marathon. Oh, Burke all day, 24 hours of Stodger.
People's Museum. And I warn you once more,
this place is alive.
This is particularly popular with the patients.
These models? This was not invented by a Russian. The man's name was Bell, Alexander Graham Bell. And he was an American. Get that, comrade. Everything on this table...
Golden Fang sells you heroin that makes your teeth rot. They provide a dentist to fix your teeth, and then arrange for you to go to a rehabilitation facility to get rid of drugs. Each time, they can charge you a fortune. If you don't have a need, they'll create a need for you. Isn't this capitalism? Mickey's change is dire for the shareholders behind Golden Fang. It means a drop in profits, and they need a lot of proletarians in order to extract surplus value.
Well, how much money would I have to take from you so I wouldn't lose your respect?
It's been late for that, Mr. Sportello. People like you lose all claim to respect the first time they pay anybody rent.
The film omits what Doc saw and heard in Vegas. In Chapter 14, Doc goes to Vegas and finds out that on the backside of the mountain, in the wasteland near Vegas, Mickey has built a community for the poor people.
He wanted to build this big place out in the desert where people could come and live for free, called Arrepentimiento.
Arrepentimiento. And what's that mean again?
Spanish for sorry about that.
This project was completely canceled after Mickey disappeared. The Air Force base near the community deliberately sent a fighter jet to fly over the community at regular intervals, and the noise was unbearable. Force Mickey to tear it down. The night before Doc leaves Vegas, he saw a John Garfield's movie on TV, I quote. And there about to begin was another John Garfield movie that James Wong Howe had also been DP on, He Ran All the Way, 1951, not one of Doc's favorites. To tell the truth, it was John Garfield's last picture before the anti-subversives finally did him in, and it had the smell of Blacklist all over it. Dalton Trumbo wrote the script, but there was another name on the credits. John Garfield played a criminal on the run who picks up Shelley Winters at a public pool and proceeds to make life disagreeable for her family, obliging them at gunpoint, for example, to eat a gross-looking prop turkey, you gonna eat dis toikey, and for his miserably misspent life he ends up, literally, dead in the gutter, though of course beautifully lit. Doc had been hoping to drift to sleep in the middle of it, but the last scene found him up and staring, sweat freezing in the air conditioning. It was somehow like seeing John Garfield die for real, with the whole respectable middle class standing there in the street smugly watching him do it. Doc's idol, American actor John Garfield, was the victim of the Hollywood blacklist. Unlike Reagan, Garfield refused to name Communist Party members or followers. Near the end of his life, in an effort to clear his name, Garfield began work on an article for Look magazine, in which he would denounce communism without naming names. His lawyer advised him to concede that he had been duped into contributing time and money to communist front groups. He then arranged to meet with the FBI to press his case. At the meeting, however, the FBI representatives showed him a dossier on his wife Roberta, which included her old Communist Party membership card and cancelled checks to events sponsored by the party, and said that the FBI would clear him if he signed a statement betraying Roberta as a communist. Garfield instead responded with an angry expletive and walked out of the meeting. On the morning of May 20, 1952, Garfield, against his doctor's strict orders, played several strenuous sets of tennis with a friend. He became ill, complaining that he felt chilled. The next morning, his friend found him dead. Long-term heart problems, allegedly aggravated by the stress of his blacklisting, had led to his death at the age of 39. Reagan became president of the United States in 1981, and his Reaganomics gave rich people more convenience and widened the gap between the rich and the poor. Doc's departure from Arrepentimiento, Mickey's community, is a metaphor that the old times are gone, a kind of resistance to the logic of capitalism is slowly disappearing. Doc, who has seen it all, returns to Los Angeles to help Bigfoot bring Golden Fang to justice, and bring Coy back to home. Doc, as a private detective, is more like Benjamin's flaneur, who wanders among wealthy businessmen, doctors, drug dealers, police officers, addicts, and black gang members. Pynchon allows us to uncritically observe all beings from the perspective of Doc, bringing out the social structure and social atmosphere of the early 1970s in America. Through the experience of a private investigator, it explores such things as racism, the original sin of white people, the mutual complementarity of capital and power, and the absurdity and arrogance in the global actions of the U.S. superpower. A true and accurate reflection of America's crux. As a hippie, Doc is obsessed with the unhurried, laid-back vibe of the 60s, as he always reminisces about those afternoons he spent with Shasta. Rains come pouring down on that new home of mine. Will you think of me and wonder if I'm fine? Will your restless heart come back to mine on a journey through the past? The sudden murder of Sharon Tate interrupted the original trajectory of life and became the dividing point of the times. Since then, civilian gatherings of more than three people have been considered a potential cult. Hippies have also been labeled cult members. When Doc saw the shell necklace that Puck was wearing around his neck, he couldn't imagine the truth behind it.
And, where you, in that necklace looks funny on you, big man, small necklace.
The fainted Doc was handcuffed. He saved himself by pulling out the shopping cart Shasta left behind from his soul. After that, Shasta disappeared from Doc's life together with that era. At the end of the film, Doc drives Shasta on a straight road, with the future obscured by a cloud of fog. In the distance, there was only a faint light guiding Doc onwards. Thank you for watching the video. If this video is helpful to you, please like and subscribe. Thank you. I will hear-